You have believed that there is a coming massive financial crisis. Explain that to me.
Okay. So my methodology for this is a complexity theory. I use behavioral economics and Bayes' theorem and a few other statistical methods, but mainly complexity theory. And the problem is every central bank in the world are using equilibrium models. They call them dynamic stochastic general equilibrium models. And the notion is...
Come right back. This is a jargon-free zone.
Okay.
Let's cut to the chase. Why are we risking a financial crisis in English?
Right. Because we are allowing the system to get larger and larger, and we don't understand risk. I was at long-term capital management, a hedge fund that nearly took down the entire financial world in 1998. We saw what happened in 2008. So in 1998, Wall Street bailed out a hedge fund. In 2008, the central banks bailed out Wall Street. In the next crisis, which could be 2018 if we keep the 10-year tempo, or tomorrow, and that's the point, who's going to bail out the central banks? See, the Federal Reserve took their balance sheet from $800 billion to $4 trillion.
Meaning it's printing money,
For
free, to buy stuff that is worthless.
Correct.
Okay, so
it's
putting
debt.
All that stuff in the bank here.
Correct.
And it's saying, don't worry, at some stage, we will resell this back to you, or we'll just keep it there? What is building?
They've pretty much given up on reselling it. What they hope to do is hold it to maturity, but the problem is they had not been able to do that. So here's the point, David. Take your balance sheet, you print $3 trillion to save the world, right? If the Fed had normalized this balance sheet, gone back down to $800 billion and got interest rates to 2-3%, which would be normal, I'd be the first one to congratulate them. I'd say, nice job, guys. You saved the world, you got your balance sheet back to normal, you got interest rates back to normal. That did not happen. The balance sheet is still here at $4 trillion. Interest rates are still very close to zero. If a crisis struck tomorrow, they're out of powder. What are they going to do?
What are they going to do?
Well, they're going to turn to the IMF. The IMF is the only clean balance sheet in the world. They will reliquify the world in the next liquidity crisis with special drawing rights.
Is the Jim Rickards view of the world that we are in these periodic crises all the time, mm-hmm. which are created by an elite which believes that printing money is the solution to everything?
I wouldn't say they're created by elites in the malevolent sense.
But
they are created by elites in the sense that the elites don't understand how the system works. If you have the wrong model, you'll get the wrong result every time. So there are these recurrent crises, but the point I was making is that each crisis is bigger than the one before. Each solution involves more money printing than the one before. We are now at the point where the central bank's capacity to print more money is capped out. So where will the money come from? A financial panic, David, best description I've ever heard. Everybody wants their money back. You know, people say, I have money in stocks, I have money in bonds. I say, no, you don't. You have stocks and bonds. That's not money. If you want money, you have to sell those things and get your money. Money in the bank is not money. It's an unsecured liability of occasionally insolvent financial institutions.
In our case, not occasionally, but regularly insolvent.
Right. Yeah. The point is, all the things that people think are money are actually not money. It's sort of, we tell ourselves the money, but in a panic, everybody says, give me the money, which is gold, silver, or cash. So the last two times they printed the money at different levels, the next time they're not going to be able to print the money, at least not in a hurry. That money will come from the International Monetary Fund. They have world money. It is world money. It has a funny name, Special Drawing Rights, SDRs. But the elites like to name things in ways that sort of hurt people's heads. They go, it's a special drawing right? I can't understand. It's just world money. Call it world money and you'll understand it perfectly. But that will eclipse, that will mean the end of the dollar as the benchmark global reserve currency. It doesn't mean the end of the dollar. As the benchmark global reserve currency.
Does the dollar fall dramatically in that case?
Well, all the currencies will fall against hard assets because it will be highly inflationary. You print 8 trillion SDRs. Notice I didn't say $8 trillion, 8 trillion SDRs. By the way, most people don't know what an SDR is worth. But I don't know either. It's worth about $1.40. There's a trading desk in the IMF. These things are out there. They're not new.
So let's stand back. So you have Trump in the United States. The central bank have used all their traditional ammunition.
Correct.
Covering the last two bailouts.
Correct.
But certainly the last one. So they have no traditional ammunition. Trump is in there. We know him to be a president that's going to have to deal with his first crisis.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? What you're saying is the next crisis could be of such panic proportions. People want all their money back, and there isn't money in the till, or if there is, it means the dollar.
Correct.
What we understand to be money and value will have to fall dramatically, and that will cause inflation, and then you're in a totally different world.
That's exactly right. And the way to prepare for that, prepare for it now.
How do you prepare for that?
Well, you have gold. I recommend 10%. Not people say, Jim Rickards says sell everything and buy gold. Yeah, I've never said that.
Most people here don't have a wad of money saying, you know, I've got gold, I've got stocks. Most people here have a little bit of savings in the bank, a couple of grand maybe, okay? And they're listening and thinking, I've got a house, which maybe I've paid for even after all the carry-on here. I've got, you know, some savings in the bank. Mm-hmm. I've got my income, my job. Okay. They're my three sources.
Well, your house is actually a good asset. The things that will go up, so gold, silver, land, property, fine art, natural resources. There are a list of things that will do very well in inflation. The things that will not do well are bonds. Now, things that will get wiped out, your pensions, your annuities, your insurance.
Pensions.
Anything that has a fixed amount in euros or dollars, if it's a fixed payment and you don't have the ability to see it go up or if it's not adjusted.
So like your pension's a great example because most people here in Ireland, if they have a pension, okay, either have a pension with the state, which is kind of a Ponzi scheme that you come in and pay a little bit more sure. tax and I get it if I retire. Yeah. But another thing is you give every month some money to some institution and this institution says, they've also got great names like the Accelerator Fund or the High Rise
sure,
Fund
it's
or whatever.
Marketing
it's never the Low Rise Fund or the Decelerator Fund.
Or the Safe Fund.
Yeah, the Safe Fund. Never though. Never the incredibly safe High Rise Accelerator Fund. But most of us say, okay, well, I put my couple of hundred quid in there, and we don't care because we trust the institution, right?
Right.
What you're saying is, don't trust them.
Well, what
because
are
they don't understand what's going on themselves.
They absolutely
that's
don't understand. That's the thing. This is not malevolent. This is more
stupidity.
The stupidity of the blind leading the blind. Actually, it's interesting. I've met, you know, central bank governors, regional reserve bank presidents, and Nobel Prize winners. It's sort of my milieu. Unfortunately, they're not stupid. They have 150, 160 IQs. They're not uneducated. They're miseducated. They've been taught to believe that certain things explain how the economy works, but those things are flawed. They don't explain how the economy works. So they're very misguided.